Now let's talk about observations and recommendations. How can we achieve the best we can within this year 2021 and the end of the year 2025? Now let's start with population. The population of Africa, which is going to be about 1.5 billion, is going to be about 18% of world population by the year 2025. And this shows that the GDP of Africa should be at least 18% of global GDP by the year 2025. But currently, the GDP of Africa is not even up to 5% of global GDP. The GDP of Africa is only about 2.8% of global GDP. And global GDP is about $89-90 trillion. Now, what should we do in order to maximize the African population? That's the question we should be asking. Because we know that if we do not maximize the population of Africa, it's going to be a disadvantage. Because if we keep having more people in Africa and more poverty, that means we're going to be watching a lot of Africans starving to death. And also, we know that the more population we have that is unemployed, we're going to have people who are going to turn out to become terrorists or going to enter into cyber crimes or Yahoo and all those crimes. Because of that, we need to do something urgently about our population. So number one, we have to create jobs in Africa. And to create jobs in Africa, it means that we should stop exporting our jobs. We have cocoa in Africa and we export cocoa to Switzerland, to Japan, to Korea, to Europe. That is exportation of jobs. And recently, the president of Ghana, President Nana Akufo-Addo, announced that he was going to stop exporting cocoa to Switzerland. And we hope he carries out that policy and starts to process the cocoa here in Africa. That will create a lot of jobs in Africa. We should stop exporting crude oil like we have been doing in Nigeria and importing finished products. We have to start working on refining those products in Africa. That's how we're going to create a lot of jobs in Africa. Number two, we have to maximize the African continental free trade area in order to have a larger market in Africa. They have the largest market in the entire world. Because population of Africa is going to exceed that of China and India. At least by the end of this year, population of Africa should exceed that of India, and by the end of the next year, we're going to exceed that of China. So we're going to have the largest population, the largest market in the world. So we have to maximize the African continental free trade area in order to increase the competitiveness of Africa's economy, as we talked about earlier, so that we can increase the productivity, marketability, and profitability of the African economy. And that will also reduce poverty in Africa. If we can increase Africa's share of global trade by some 1%, at least 200 million Africans are going to be lifted out of poverty, according to experts. And the way to increase Africa's share of global GDP is through this African continental free trade area, which will give Africans more access to the African market. So we have to maximize the African continental free trade area. And number three, we have to improve education in Africa. This system of education that is just so generic. You go to secondary school, you finish secondary school, you go to university, finish university, start looking for a job. It cannot work. It cannot work in Africa. We need a comprehensive educational system. An education system that is built for the industrialization of Africa. If not, we keep producing people who are looking for jobs, keep producing people who are dependent on Europeans doing everything for us. So we have to create a system, an education system that creates people who are self-reliant, that creates people who are producers and not those who are consumers. Number four, responsible parenting. Parents in Africa should give birth to children just the amount that they can take care of. If you can take care of 3 children based on your income, don't give birth to 6 children or to 7 children or to 10 children. If you can give birth to 2, and 2 is the number you can take care of, give birth to 2. Also, the government should mandate that parents must take care of their children. Parents must ensure that their children are well educated. And also, the government in Africa must take care of the children that we have in Africa to make sure that every child is well educated, and not just ability to read and write, but ability to produce. And fifthly, Africa must become a producing continent instead of a consuming continent, which relates to what we talked about in number one recommendation, that we should stop exporting our jobs. So we should start producing those things to go to Europe to buy in Africa, so that our population will have something to do. If not, the population will then become a disadvantage and cause many crises in Africa. Then let's go to number two, urbanization. how do we urbanize Africa the right way, and what should we do? Over 60% of urban dwellers in Africa dwell in slums and shacks, and which is not good. So we have to like refurbish even those slums, because we're not going to destroy all of them at once. Because if you want to destroy all of them and build new cities entirely, we're going to be destroying the homes of over 60% of urban dwellers in Africa, which is not going to, we're not going to easily rebuild at once. So we need to rework the cities we have in Africa, the urban areas we have in Africa. We have to beautify them more. We have to make sure that all the urban areas in Africa are well planned, so that when people are building new houses, they are building according to plan. And to remove all these ugly structures that make areas to become eyesores, make sure that the areas that whatever people want to move into Africa, and those areas that the government should go first and plan those areas. The urban planners should be more serious in their job and plan up those areas, so that when people are building houses, are buying land, building houses, they're not going to build in anything. They're going to build in according to standard, so that the new houses we build in Africa will be according to plan, well-planned urban areas, so that we do not just build houses and build anything, and in the end, we keep having slums and shacks. And also, another way to make sure that the urban areas are looking better is in uniformity. You go to some cities, you find out that this person will paint his house blue, another person will paint red, green, yellow, purple, and all different colors, and everything looks so untidy. I think one of the best ways to have better looking cities in Africa is to make sure that areas in Africa have particular color theme that you can paint your house. For example, this particular area should paint only white and maybe with yellow design, and here only white with black design, and here only white with green design, something like that. There might be some form of uniformity, maybe in terms of the painting of the housing, in terms of the color of the roofs, and in terms of the type of house they build. Here should be only duplex, here should be only bungalow, here should be only flats. So if you have that kind of uniformity in the cities we are building in Africa, and in terms of like reworking the old cities, I think that would be a very little way, or a less costly way, of having better cities in Africa from the existing slums we have. And the government should also help in building new cities. The government mustn't go in terms of building new cities entirely. At least map out new areas close to existing cities and build roads, put the systems in place like the electricity and pipe and water, and people go to those places, buy land, and start building according to plan. The color they paint their houses, the type of houses they're going to build, the color of the thing, and so on, as I mentioned earlier. So that will be able to give us better cities in Africa. And thirdly, the government should make the building materials to be more affordable. The cost of cement should be drastically reduced. Instead of the price of cement increasing from time to time, we're supposed to have the price of cement dropping, so that the many Africans can be able to afford to build their own homes. And number three, literacy in Africa. What should we do about literacy in Africa? You know that one of the reasons why the literacy rate in Africa is not as high as that of the other parts of the world, 70 compared to 90% in the world, is because of conflict. Many African states are experiencing conflict. For example, South Sudan, they expect literacy rate in South Sudan to be 100%, whereas South Sudan has been experiencing conflict for over 50 years now. Right from when they were with Sudan, and since after independence, there has been conflict upon conflict upon conflict. You cannot expect South Sudan to have the same literacy rate as that of the UK. So one of the reasons is lack of peace. So the way to have high literacy rate in Africa, one of the ways is to make sure that there is peace across Africa. And when there's peace, people can send their children to school, and people can be able to afford school fees to pay for their children. And another thing, reason that causes poor literacy rates in Africa, or let me say poor literacy rates, the one of the reasons why we do not have the amount of literacy rates we're supposed to have in Africa is, or level of literacy rates we're supposed to have in Africa, is because of some institutions, some mental institutions, and some social institutions. For example, in northern Nigeria, we have the Amajiri system that children give birth to their parents give birth to their children and allow their children to be roaming around the streets to beg. And they believe that it is a form of you see, worship or so. I don't know why they, that's this kind of system. So that system needs to be dismantled. And the governors in another part of Nigeria, they have been talking about how to bring that system to an end. And they have passed some resolutions to end that system. And that system should be brought completely to an end. And that is one of the reasons why Northern Nigeria has a very low level of literacy rate compared to other parts of Nigeria. Another thing that needs to be taken care of is this mentality that the girl child should not be educated, that you if you educate your girl child, that the girl child will be married off and that investment will be lost. That is a wrong mentality. A girl child is as important as a male child. If you take care of your girl child, even if she marries another into another family, which is bound to happen, she can still take care of your family. She can still take care of you. And even female children take care of their parents even more than the male children in most cases. So take care of your female child, take care of the male child. If you can send both to school, send the two children to school, both the male and the female to school. So the African Union and African heads of state must take care of these institutions, mental institution, mental paradigm, and make sure that every parent must be held responsible. If your child is not educated at least to the secondary level, you should be held responsible. Because bringing a child into this world and not taking care of that child, not giving that child quality education, is like denying that child his or her ticket to success. And it is not proper. The government should hold such parents responsible. That is one of the ways to have high literacy rates in Africa. Now, let's talk about electric cars in Africa. How can we have more electric cars in Africa by the year 2025 and beyond? Number one, first of all, we want to understand that to build electric cars, it requires the skill and requires the fund. Our education system, we have to start building technical schools across Africa. This system of grammatical education, where you go to school to speak good English or to speak good French or to just learn biology and come out of school and start telling people we have learned biology, that system of education will not produce much in Africa, and we will be seeing that it's not producing anything much. We need technical schools across Africa, which is one of the reasons why Germany has a very high level of industrialization and a very low level of unemployment. So we have to start building technical schools across Africa. At least 2 out of 3 secondary schools in Africa should be technical schools. We should have automobile technical schools that focus on aircraft, engine, and building of drones and so on. When we have all those diversified technical schools instead from secondary schools up, then we can begin to have the skills to build industrialization in Africa. We can begin to build our own electric cars in Africa, and not just having one company, but we have several of them. We have a lot of skilled Africans just from secondary schools. So that is one of the keys, and the government should also provide funds for those who want to venture into such businesses so that they can be able to start up and begin to build such technologies. And also, in our education system, we should also teach how to raise funds, because if you have an idea and don't know how to get the fund to begin that idea is going to lie waste. And in our schools, we don't learn how to raise money in order to begin our businesses. But in Europe, in America especially, you see, they have an idea, they know how to go about to get the money to start up that business, because of that they have many ICT companies in America. So we also need to teach our students how to raise the funds to begin their own businesses. Then, peace and conflict in Africa. What should we do in Africa in order to have more peace in Africa? And first of all, let's talk about the roots of conflict in Africa. The roots of the conflict in Africa, some of them include ethnic domination. One ethnic group wants to dominate the other. Number two, colonial legacy. The colonizers put one ethnic group against other. They created the first dysfunctional systems across Africa, and bad leadership and so on. So we need an institution that can take care of all these causes of conflict in Africa so that we can have as little conflict in Africa as possible. So we need an African parliament. So we need an African parliament that will begin to look into issues in Africa so that we can resolve all these conflicts. Conflict that have to do with colonization, new colonialism. Also, we need an ethnic congress to look into issues that have to do with ethnicity in Africa, so that we can have peace between ethnic groups. And that peace can only come where there is justice. Peace between ethnic groups cannot come when one ethnic group is killing another. And you tell me to accept peace as an African, I can't accept that kind of peace. I'm sorry. And I will never accept it forever. The only peace I can accept, the only peace you can accept, is where there is justice. And that is true peace. True peace is the acceptance of justice. And that is the only way we can have peace in Africa. So we must have an African parliament and an African ethnic parliament in order to discuss issues that relate to peace in Africa. And we must also have accountable leadership in Africa, because we have leaders that want to rule forever. And you check, they rule for 30 years, you cannot account for anything that they achieve in 30 years. It was going to cause conflict. So the African parliament was, you also pass laws to restrict the amount of time leaders can spend in office. And also I talked about the leadership by objective in how to have the best leadership in Africa. That the leadership by objective must be implemented across Africa in order to have the best leadership in the world. And that leadership by objective will also reduce the amount of conflict in Africa, because bad leadership engenders conflict and causes lack of peace. Just like United Nations Resolution 1514, which was signed on the 14th of December 1960, gave colonies across the world the right for self-independence, for independence. That is how the African Union should also pass a resolution that all ethnic groups in Africa should have the right to self-determination, and guarantee that referendum that all African states should allow for groups in Africa who want to have states of their own should have it, to have it. Then we can then have the United States of Africa as a super state for all Africans. That is one of the ways in which we must have peace in Africa, so that we won't keep having self-determination groups fighting and creating civil wars across Africa. So let the United Nations, or let the African Union, take an action towards this direction. So unemployment in Africa, if we implement what I talked about in education and that's of population, then we also have a reduction in amount of unemployment in Africa. Then electricity in Africa, how do we improve electricity in Africa? Number one, government must fund researches into alternative energy supply systems like solar, biogas, and so on, so that we can have many systems providing energy in Africa. And the government must also, African Union must speed up the building of the Enga Dam, which is also going to supply light to a lot of Africans. And in terms of migration, how do we reduce the amount of Africans that leave Africa annually? Yeah, it's to develop Africa by building the economy, the African continental free trade area, maximizing it so that we can have movement of Africans in between Africa, and providing jobs, as we talked about earlier. Then the African continental free trade area, how can we maximize it in order to have the best idea 2025 and beyond? First of all, one of the major challenges of the facing the African continental free trade area is poor infrastructure. For example, if you want to move your goods from Niger to South Africa, how are you going to move your goods from Niger to South Africa? How are you going to do that? The best way to move goods and services intracontinentally is through the railway system. And we do not have railway system connecting all Africa. We use road, and we know the poor road network we have in some parts of Africa. And yes, there's rapid improvement going on across Africa, especially in Egypt, Mauritius, and Rwanda, Tanzania also. Now, we need an African continental railway system to maximize the African continental free trade area. And we know that 5 years might not be enough to build that system. So if we can begin now to build railway system that can connect the entire Africa, I believe by the year 2025, at least we must have gone halfway or 75% completed. So there should be a railway system connecting all Africa, so that if you want to move from Niger to South Africa, all you have to do is to enter a speed train, and that speed train will take you straight to South Africa. So that by within 12 hours or less than 12 hours, you are in South Africa. But if you have to travel by road, how are you going to travel by road from South Africa or Niger to South Africa? It's going to take you days, probably a week, to travel by road. And if you want to move goods from, let's say, Libya to Namibia, how long are you going to stay on the road to move goods from Libya to Namibia? So if you have an African continental railway system, you can easily move goods from one part of Africa to another. Actually, this fast train system, some of them move at least 600 miles per hour. So you can cover a lot of space or distance in just a short period of time. And you can also move goods and people from one place to another in a short period of time. Also, how can we be talking about African continental free trade area moving people and goods and services across Africa, and we still do not yet have an African passport which you can move from one African state to the other? How come we still require the visas to move from one part of Africa to the other? To me, it's just a kind of irony. So there must be that African passport and an African policy that you can move from one part of Africa to another, like you can do in ECOWAS. You can move from one part of ECOWAS to another without the need for visa. All you need is a passport and can stay there for 90 days before you can go for maybe a green card or visa or whatever. So that should also be part of the African continental free trade area. I'm surprised I've not seen anything as such. So we need that infrastructure and we need that free movement of people and goods and services indeed in order to maximize the continental free trade area. And also to maximize the African continental free trade area, we have to start mapping out a system of division of labor. For example, Ghana, you produce cocoa. Where are we going to build the refineries for cocoa processing in Africa? Which country in Africa, which state in Africa will take it up to build the chocolate factories in Africa, to build the best you can have in Africa? And all that, if you can keep, if you have something like that, coffee produced in Ethiopia, which African state can take it upon herself to be the state that will be processing the coffee into finished product? So that's another thing we have to find out and establish in Africa so we can maximize the African continental free trade area. Oh, finally, leadership is where everything is going to rise and fall. According to John Maxwell, everything rises and falls on leadership. It rests on the shoulders of African leaders to implement all these recommendations and to even implement other better, far better recommendations that can make Africa better by the year 2025. And we, the people of Africa, undoubtedly, we have our own role to play in order to make Africa better by the year 2025 for us and beyond 2025. The future is in our hand and we can determine how we want it to look. As Abraham Lincoln once said, the best way to predict your future is to create it. Let us create that future that we want to see in Africa by the year 2025 and beyond. God bless Africa.